not or is none of them. It's actually a story. I remember I was living in Arizona, and it was a story about something that happened in New Mexico. And I don't know, I'm doing this thing now. So it had to do with a strange health case in this little town, a southern town, and people were getting sick and they weren't sure what it was. And you know, it wasn't kind of like a super unusual story at first. Turned out, someone said, you know, test the air in the community, test the soil, test the water. And sure enough, they found that the water was incredibly polluted. But they found the strangest things in the water. Incredible poisons, incredible toxins, almost as if people were trying to kill the city. But this was sort of like, I can't even remember the name of the city, that kind of city. Who would want to do that? And so they kept testing in different households, and they started going in larger and larger radius until they realized that the water table was more toxic and concentrated as they were moving further out in one direction. And what they discovered was that on a beautiful little family farm, there was a well. And then for two or three generations, literally, like an old-fashioned well that had been there for, you know, like 100 years, big hole going way down. And for a few generations, that's where they were putting all their toxic trash, batteries, old gas cans, paint. It was a beautiful farm. They cared for it immaculately. And the great-grandfather, of course, back in the day, had no concept that there could be anything possibly wrong with throwing all his lead-based paint and his car batteries down to this hole. I mean, think about it. After they threw it in, it was gone. And the planet's like, what, 75, 80% water? Couldn't possibly hurt that. And yet, as it turns out, after enough time, year after year, generation after generation, what they found at the bottom was just a cesspool of what had become toxic waste. And now, it was getting into the water table and people were drinking it. Can you picture that? So now let's talk about grief. Anyone ever have a disappointment that you just never really took the time to talk to someone about? I don't know. Or have a loss? Or a feeling of brokenness? Or a missed opportunity or a failed relationship? Anyone? Or is that, I just described myself. And rather than bringing it out in the light and really feeling it, seeing it, healing it, you decided to just kind of throw it in the well. Grief is an interesting thing. Some of you have been in classes with me about grief. If you don't know, first of all, grief, until felt and fully experienced, never goes away. That's good news, isn't it? Sorry. It also doesn't go into special compartments like we wish. Like, here's the grief for not getting picked for the soccer team. And over here is where I put the grief for not getting my way as a kid because I was the youngest. And here's where I stuffed my grief because my dog died when I was 12 and no one explained why. And then there was the grief of a lost job, and then there was the grief of a failed marriage, and then there was the grief of... And it all just goes into the same well. And it gathers. And it gathers, and it gathers. And then we face this risk, every one of us, that one day, one of two things will happen. which is either that the well itself will crack under the pressure and we will simply lose it. One more thing, unexpected, will be poured in to the point of overflow. And in both cases, control is lost, and the grief pours out, and we feel lost in it, and we wonder, will this ever stop? Will I ever be happy again? Will I ever feel whole again? And how could I let this happen? It's a shock. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, think about it. Have you ever been driving down the highway after a hard week or a difficult month or just too many things not going the way you thought they were going to go? And then that song comes on, or that news story comes on, and before you know it, you're sobbing, alone, hoping that no one else is looking in the express lane. Is that just me? Like every Sunday on the way to Althea? I'd say some of us, perhaps, when your heart is open and you are in touch with your feelings on a regular basis, may have this happen more often than not. Anyone willing to admit that? Are you one of those people? Who's there? There's a phone. That's a bunch of you. Great, I'm not alone. But the truth is, we all have those moments at some point or another. And the most terrifying thing, really, are the times in our life where we don't have those moments. Because that means the well is filling up. And no one escapes it. It's the human condition. But here's the thing that's really struck me lately, and this is the message that we've shared earlier. For the longest time, actually all my life, as I've taught about grief and facilitated grief groups, I've always only talked about personal grief. Even when we talk about our sadness in relationship to what's going on in the world, it's always as a personal experience. Like people will say, do you think it's possible? I'm not even feeling my own sadness, but the sadness for all the loss that's going on. I say, yes. And is it possible I'm adding that into my well? And I'd say, yes. But I always drew the picture as like a vessel. You know what I mean? With a bottom on it, and then it's filling, filling, filling. Picture that? But that's not it at all. It's a well, like the well on that farm in New Mexico. And it's true that what we're putting in is slowly building up, slowly coming to the top to overflow, but it is also true, like that poison well, that what goes down deep into our hearts goes into the heart of the world. There is no loss or sorrow that we are disconnected from. We can't sit here together and say, God is all. We can't sit here and say, Spirit is the oneness of life. We are interconnected, and yet not share our pain, our sorrow, and our loss. At some point, the groundwater of grief itself will rise, filling any well that it can, any well open enough. And if yours is not so open, then it will at the very least diminish your capacity to fill your own well. Can you picture that? Can anyone picture that? Can I see nodding heads or shaking heads? So do you know what a well does? So you dig a hole, goes down to the water table. The well belongs to the individual farmer or property. The water table doesn't. It moves between all the properties. And that is what we share. What we draw out of the well is what is ours uniquely, individually. What we put in may ours uniquely, individually, but where it goes is collective. And that means that when we are feeling struggle and stress and sorrow for what's going on in the world today, we have the opportunity, and I would say even the responsibility, to grieve, not just for ourselves, but for all the unfelt grief, for all the unfelt loss. And in so doing, through the metaphysics of the heart of this universe, we can bring a healing to all. What heals it? What heals grief? Feeling it. That's it. The one thing no one wants to do, to feel their sorrow so fully it might consume them, that it feels like it might never end. But when we stand courageously and allow it, welcome it, enter into it, we discover, and many of you have been through this many times, it does pass, it does move on, and it does so most powerfully when we share it with others. And so, if you have any feeling for what's going on in the world today, if you are carrying around sorrow or sadness or grief, we have an opportunity for you now to participate in something. And I'm going to need 5 volunteers. I'm also going to call Pam up, if you could please. Pam's going to help assist. And then Alan's going to come assist. Catherine, I need Catherine to come up. And before you get here too fast, let me tell you what you're volunteering for. We'd like you to stand for the grief, for the horrific grief of one of our world's communities. And we need you to come up here and name it. Who is it you will stand here for today? Is it Las Vegas? Is it Puerto Rico? Is it Venezuela? Who will you stand for today? And because we can't name all communities, I'm going to ask Pam to stand for humanity, our human condition. She's going to write the word humanity on this sheet. She's going to hang it elegantly around her neck. And Catherine, I'm going to ask Catherine to come up. We here are a community more than 100 years old, almost 100 years of just this building. And our community also, imagine all the funerals and the memorials and the deaths and the disappointments and the losses and the surprises and the tragedies. Our community also carries a collective grief. I'm going to ask you to write Althea on one of these.